light. There we go. Turn the red button white. Turn the white button red. Turn the red button white.
Your nose. Oh, I took a wound. Oh, I got rubbered. Oh, I got a little nosy. Oh, I got a little bun running there too. What happened? I got burned. Oh, I took a bun. Poor buddy. Oh, my little guy. Yeah, I got wounded.
Alright. So anyway, so yeah, see? That was A6, E3, F4. A5. A6, E3, F4. A6. Gist of the story is that he's saying, this is proof against you, my Israelite brothers. You can't even control your tongue. Yet you can put a bridle in a horse's mouth and steer him wherever you want to go, right? But you can't control your own tongue. This is evidence against you that you can't be perfect and perform all the perfect requirements of the law of Moses. Thus, you can't be perfect and be like the Most High, of which Satan tried and got kicked out. And thus he used that same idea to trick Eve, to get her to think that she could be like the Most High, that got her kicked out. And when she got kicked out, Adam willfully laid down his life to bear the punishment with her and be kicked out too, in hopes that the Most High would save them somehow. Stop the bridal pain. Because that's exactly what the law of Moses does to a man. It causes him to try to do things he can't do. And when he tries to do things he can't do, it's like lifting a weight so heavy he can't lift it. If he does manage to get it up so high, it's going to finally collapse on him and grind him to powder. Because nobody can be like the Most High. Only the Most High can perform his perfect commands. And he gave us those commands as a way to show us the only way that it could be done. Those commands were given to us to show us that for all eternity, we are going to worship him. And we are going to have a full understanding that he is all superior. And we are just the creation made for his pleasure. Stop the bride. Stop the bridal pain. emotions are we using here? The number 6 emotion, the number 3 emotion, and the number 4 emotion in the key of E. And that key is, if we start on A, B, A sharp, B, C, C sharp, D, E, no, D, D sharp, E, F, G, A, oh, C, yeah, A sharp, B, C, that key is the fourth key. C is the fourth key. There's 12 keys all together. C is the fourth key. A is the sixth note in the fourth key. Each key has 7 notes in it. A6. A6 arpeggios, and I threw in some diminished arpeggios to decorate it up a little bit, color it up a little bit, a little bit of eternity in there. That's that number 7 note, the diminished 7th. Here's an A6 arpeggio. Here's a diminished 7th arpeggio. F based. Here's another inversion of the A6 arpeggio. Here's another F based inversion diminished 7th arpeggio. Here's a third inversion of the A6 arpeggio. Here's the third version of the diminished 7th F-based arpeggio. So I go back and forth between each one to give it a little bit of color. An A6 arpeggio, an F-based diminished 7th arpeggio, another A6 arpeggio, another F-based diminished 7th arpeggio. It's just that each one is a little higher in tone than the next, or it's what's referred to as another inversion. In other words, it starts on a different note within the arpeggio. And an arpeggio has 3 notes in it. So if we start on this note of the arpeggio, that's the first inversion. That note right there. Go to the next note, that's the second inversion. We go to the third note, that's the third inversion. Anyway, that's just a little side note. A6, it's the key of C. A6, it's the key of C. Emotion. All we have to do to create a different part in the song is just hold one of the notes. It's kind of like if you have a girl that you love, you hold her. When you hold the note, when you hold something, right? You hold it. All of a sudden, what happens? Feelings start to arise. Hold it. In other words, knowing when to stop. Right? Setting our stop losses, right? Put our Forex trade on. Put our stop loss in there, right? Otherwise, what? It'll blow up our account. Margin out, man. Put a stop loss on it. Stop. Hold it. Wait for another trade. Stop. Hold it. Wait for another trade. Stop. Hold it. Wait for another trade set up. Stop. Hold it. Wait for another trade.
Humboldt! Is it Bob or Tiny? A Tiny has stiff tail.
Usually her tail's limp. It's stiff right now.
Tail stiff?
I can tell just by holding my cat's tail what cat it is. I pick up a certain cat's tail, it's stiff. That's Boob. She's more of a scared one. She doesn't have a lot of trust. She's like her mama. She likes to be by herself a lot. Get close to her and try to hold her, she starts to stiffen up. She's not used to it.
Huh. They had stiff tail right now. Yeah, I wasn't feeling limp. Now I'm limp.
There's your tail's all limp now.
I'm loosened up now. I'm loosened up. Feeling good.
Thank you. I just popped a string. Broke a string, 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 broke a string. So what I do when they break at the bridge, I just pull it up so it unwinds. String unwinds from the middle part. Turn the guitar off. I broke a number 5 string. So you can see, all I do is just play some chords, choose some emotions, play them over and over again, and then my mind automatically creates melodies. And I just make sounds with my mouth for the melodies, and then later on I can put lyrics to them. So. So. That's all it is, man. Choose a chord, choose 2 chords. Play them back and forth. Wait for a melody, for the mind to create a melody. And then the melody goes to the mouth and sing it out. Sing it back and forth for a while, and then when we're tired of it, pick a new chord. Pick 2 new chords, or just hold 1 chord. Do something. You know, make it simple, just stay in 1 key. So, you know, figure out what the notes are for 1 key, all the chords. Each note is a chord, each chord is a note. A chord is just 1 note, another note put together, played at the same time. That sound good. And others don't sound so good, but that depends on the beholder. One man's garbage is another man's treasure. Something that one man don't like, 2 notes that one man don't like put together, another man likes put together. Some women like it too. I'm always singing melodies. Melodies are popping in my mind all the time because I've been trained by commercials from being raised on TV. You know, watching TV a lot when I was young. I didn't watch it a lot, but I usually stayed in my room most of the time. Everybody else was out watching TV. But for the most part, when I did watch TV, and when I got my own place, I watched some TV for a while. You know, you get a commercial to come on and have a quick little jingle song to get to the brighter product. So I always got little jingle songs going through my mind. I'll wake up in the morning with a brand new jingle song will just pop up. I'll be singing it to myself, to the cats while I'm making food and stuff like that. A new jingle every day, man. It's just automatic for me because my mind's been so trained, you know, to be musical all the time. Because I do music all the time, so. But a lot of us who don't do music, we got little jingles going through our head. We'll wake up in the morning, a little something, we'll just sing it out, sing in the shower or something. So it's really just kind of built in all of us. Some of us are just more repressed than others of letting it out. Especially if we have people that we live with, you know, we're not free. Whereas we're living by ourselves, we can sing whatever we want. We don't have to worry about people making fun of us. So. And that can be hard to overcome. It is for me. I don't do about singing in front of people. It is my goal to do it, though. You know, I know my weaknesses and my strengths and my weaknesses and what I want to improve on, but, you know. But is it really that important that I improve on it? No. What's important is that I have my salvation. I'm going to eternal life. That's what's really important. All this other stuff that we have to deal with here in life, yeah, it's a fart in the wind, man. Just a fart in the wind. So we just put up with it till, you know, eternity comes and everything will be much better. It's not a big deal to have to go through hard times on earth. So, you know, if we think of it in that perspective, in all actuality, that's what helps us get through the hard times, is realizing that. Is that it's not going to be permanent. And this life is just a fart in the wind. 70 years, 100 years here on earth, some of us live 50, maybe 30, maybe 120 years at the most. That's the max a man will live, is 120 years. Around that area. Who knows? But the reason I say that is because the Most High said that. He said, man's life will now be 120 years, because Noah lived 900 years and all those other early dudes. So, but after the flood, Most High said, nope, everybody's going to live a maximum of 120 years at the most. So anyway, 120 years compared to eternity, that's a fart in the wind. We won't even remember this life. In fact, I was reading in Psalms, verse 65, it says something about we're not even going to remember the former things. It's going to be a fart in the wind, man. So, you know, going through hard times and all this stuff that we have to go through, peer pressure and all that, if we think about it in the right perspective, it don't matter. And that's what gets us through it. And when we realize it don't matter, then life actually becomes much more pleasurable in the wait, while we're waiting for our eternal bodies and our new earth and all that other good stuff. Of course, the only ones of us that are going to have eternal life are those of us that understand the knowledge of the sin. So if you don't understand that knowledge, go to my YouTube channel, Just Play Man. Type in the YouTube search, The Sin, Just Play Man, and start watching the video series that I made on it. I've got all kinds of videos on it. And there's all kinds of websites to go to, and there's a book to buy that, you know, other men wrote, and it's another man's website. But the book to buy is only like $3. Buy it used on Amazon. It's called The Gospel Solution by Tom Weaver. It's on my channel page. So. And then the guy who has a website, all his material's free. You download it, print it up, whatever. He has free audios, and he's always doing new lessons every week, puts them on audio. About once every 2 months, he loads up his messages. So, twosonsofgod.org. So that website's on the channel too. We can learn all about what real salvation is. Those of us who get real salvation, those are the only ones of us that are going to go to eternity. Otherwise, this fart in the life wind is going to be a drag in eternal death. It's going to go from worse to worser. And it doesn't say anything about in the scripture about them not remembering what a drag it was. All recorded too. It turned out to be good shows.
A tiny. See? We're recording up here. See? Here, pick a size. Right there. I could be. Yeah, right there. It's a little tiny. It's a tiny little thing. It's a good girl. Where were bunny? Where were bunny? Hey, where my bunny? What the hey? Kind of feels good. Rubber bunny. The rubber bunny, meet the rubber bunny. Ah, my rubber bunny. Hey, you rubbed my bunny.
I'm kind of tired. tired of playing guitar anyway. I fixed it, so we'll end this one.
Choose a particular emotion at will and just play that particular chord or chord set of chords together and feel a certain feel, you know, we can feel a certain way by choosing it. We can choose to feel a certain way by playing certain chords. We don't know how to feel, so we just pick something to play. We go, oh, well, that'll do. Yet she's the lap cat. She's the one that has to be laying on me all the time. But hold her down, she's like, she don't want to have any part of that. She wants to be able to lay on me anytime she wants.
I want to lay on you any way I want, any time I want. Just be still. Just lay right there, be still. Laying right there, that's it. And if you move slowly, don't be moving fast on me. Boing, 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 boing.
I finally figured out how to use my hair cutter that I bought from the store the other day. Figured out how to use it and to set it on high so I can get at least a decent haircut, and I can keep it at the same length all the time now. When I first bought it, I was like, I got home, I went in there and I started doing it, and next thing you know, it's like,
whoa, I just knocked all my hair off right here on the side.
So I was like, I should have just left it like that, because that could have been in fashion. You know, some people do that. They just put a little shave right there on the side and it's in fashion. You know? I should have just left it, because my head was cold, man. After I did it, I had to wear a hat. It was just toward the end of winter, so I had to go another month of cold when the summer came. That way I figured out how to use it on the high setting. My head's kind of cold, so it's not long enough. I want it to be a little longer, but at least it's not all like shaved looking. It's got a little style on the top, and it's got some thickness throughout it, and it's even throughout everywhere. And it's just, all they gotta do is just, so now, next time I do it, the hair's getting a little long, just, and I'm done, free, no haircut, no $25 a month, no $13 a month or whatever. Of course, I stopped going to the barber about 2 years ago. I started learning how to cut my own hair again there with the scissors. Did a pretty good job with a mirror and everything. The razor in the back, get all the different angles, trying about 100 times before I got it right, and then put it in.
Yeah.
Now, I'm good to go. I got my little trimmer, beard trimmer. I just trim it, you know, once a week or so, get it down. tears my skin up. I just keep it down to the lowest trim. Now, whenever my hair gets a little long, I just... In fact, I could probably do it once a week and just keep it all the same length, all the same time. It would be cool.
What do you want? A little cookie? You want a cookie? Get your hand, you little cat.
She's a little beggar, too. She's always wanting food.
Here you go.
But anyway, I need to find a trimmer that goes at least to an inch and a half. I want an inch and a quarter probably, because this goes about 7/8 of an inch, close to an inch probably is how high it goes. If I can get one about an inch and a quarter, maybe an inch and a half, that'd be best. If I find one, I'm gonna get it. And it has to be cordless too. Remember, it's cord stuff. It has to be cordless. That's what you call brainstem stimulation. I watched it on a YouTube video. It's very healthy to do because the nerves get bunched up down inside the vertebra in the brainstem area. So they get all tightened up, bunched up, and they need to be loosened up. So what we do, just kind of roll our head, you know. Anyway, we can do it any speed we want. And then what really works too is we give ourselves a neck massage back there. Massage the nerves and the muscles and the brainstem area, and it stimulates stuff. So, and then we can do things like, you know, if we have pain in the lower back, like as we're rubbing it, we can direct our attention toward that lower back area, and it actually starts to alleviate the pain. And if we keep doing it every day, you know, it helps to heal that area. So we can actually send brain signals to areas of our body to heal them. You know, developing the habit, that's the hard part. But I tried it a couple times, and I was like, well, I can notice a little bit of difference, pain alleviating my lower back. You know, I'd just be sitting here, I'd be rubbing it, you know, and I'd be thinking about my lower back, like sending electrical signals to my lower back where the pain's at. It's like the signals know where to go when we tell them where to go. And we tell our brain, okay, send some healing signals down to our pain in our lower back. And so our brain automatically knows what to do. So, but if we're not consistent with it, you know, then you know, the pain's just going to keep being there. So I'm working on it. See if I can alleviate pain more, you know. Feel more healthy than this and that. But like I said, you know, pain and feeling good and all that, it's really not necessary. It's nice to feel more comfortable in this life, but it's not necessary, you know. Because there'll be days, you know, for those of us that go into eternity, you know, you no more tears, no more pain, man. That's just going to be a thing of the past. You won't even remember it. Yeah, it'll be gone. It's just like just a fart in the wind. The only thing this life is all about is to learn that He, that our Creator, is more superior than us. And we are just His creation made for His pleasure. That's all this life is here for us to learn. That's why we go through this life. So when we get to eternity, we have that full understanding. Have what's called wisdom. That is wisdom. Wisdom is not knowing 2 plus 2 and 4 and 4 and algebra and all this other psychology of life. That's not wisdom. That's just knowledge. Wisdom is coming to an understanding that our Creator is superior. And we cannot in any way be like Him. balanced. He ain't like Satan. Satan tries to be like the Most High. He tries to be loving. But his way of loving is manipulation, right? Everything he does is set up for destruction, to destroy things. Right? Now, he can make it look like he's loving, you know, but in the end, it's made to destroy. Why? Because Satan is just a creation. He ain't the creator. He's a creation, and he was not created with the capacity to be like the creator. None of the creator's creations were created with the capacity to be like the creator. That's just the way it is. I want to know more in depth why that is. And, you know, that's one of the questions I posed to him. So, you know, I'm waiting for my answer. But I'm satisfied knowing just, you know, knowing what wisdom is. When James talks about wisdom, you know, most preachers in churches, what do they say? It's, oh, James says to get wisdom. And they say, wisdom is believing on the Lord Jesus, and you'll be saved. And then they teach you the law of Moses. Now go around loving your neighbor as yourself. Be like a good Samaritan. Let your light shine on a candlestick. Build your house on the rock. That's all the law of Moses, man. We can't love our neighbors as ourselves. Yeshua gave us two new commands. He said, a new command I give unto you. Remember reading that in the scriptures, don't you? Remember hearing that? That should be an obvious point right off the bat. A new command I give unto you. What's the new command? Just love your brother. There's no high measure put on it. We're not to love our brother as we love ourselves. If we were to love our brothers as we love ourselves, that would mean giving him our credit card to go buy whatever he wants. Can we do that? No! Who can do that? Who's the only one that's capable of doing that? The Creator. Only he can do such things. Remember the parable of the Good Samaritan in the New Testament? Remember the lawyer? He goes up to Yeshua. He says, "What's a good thing when I do didn't hear eternal life?" And Yeshua looks at him and says, "Well, what's the commandment say, huh?" And the lawyer says, "Love my neighbor as myself, and love the Lord, heart, all mind, and strength, and all that." And Yeshua looks at him and he says, "Well, go do it." In other words, Yeshua is like, come on, let's see you actually do it for me. If you want to get your eternal life, do it. Come on. And so the lawyer looks at Yeshua and he says, well, who's my neighbor? Trying to justify himself, trying to worm his way out of it. Because he knows he's been cornered with the truth. Right? Well, he doesn't know he's been cornered with the truth. He's just feeling his emotions evoked. His emotions are feeling something. He knows that something's not right. His emotions are stirring up in his mind. Oh, something's not right here. Something's not right. He doesn't know exactly what it is yet, because nobody's going to know until after the Messiah dies and raises again and sends the Holy Spirit into men's hearts to teach them what he meant. Especially after the Apostle Paul, who was the only man that was personally taught by Yeshua in a desert, explained to Paul what he meant. The parable of the Good Samaritan, right? The lawyer asked Yeshua, "Help me, who's my neighbor?" Right? You know, that's basically the kind of snide accent that, you know, he would have. Not necessarily that he said it that way, but I'm just being dramatic so we get an idea of what his attitude's going on in his mind, the attitude we can't see. Right? That's what the attitude is. "Man, who's my neighbor?" as though you know, he stands justified in his position, as though Yeshua could never give him an answer that's suitable. But what's Yeshua do? He gives him the parable of the Good Samaritan and sends him on his way with his emotions evoked, thinking, can he be like this Samaritan and go around and help everyone on the earth, feet up on the road, half dead, put them on their donkeys, use all their band-aids and oil and stuff to get them well, take them to the inn, or in today's terms, it'd be take them to the hospital, tell the captain at the hospital whatever he needs to get well, put it on my bill. Well, if this guy is beat up on the road, half dead, think about he might be turn out to be a vegetable all his life. He got beat up so hard, right? If he's going to be a vegetable all his life, that's going to be put on your bill for the rest of your life. Now, go around and do that for everybody in the earth. Not just one person, because if you want to be like the Most High, you got to do it for everybody. You got to help everybody. The only one that can help everybody is the Most High himself. He's the only one that's capable of doing that. Not that he's going to do it, but he has the capacity to do it if he wanted to. That's the most important point. Only he can perform his commandments. And only he can perform the word stories in these parables that he's sharing with these Israelites. And he's telling these Israelites these parables to provoke their emotions. All he's doing is just preparing their emotions to send them away feeling something in their mind, thinking, there's something not right here. I think I've got my eternal life, and I think I'm performing the law of Moses good enough to get my eternal life. Right? Yeshua is sending them away with these word pictures that were designed to stir their emotions up, to cause them to start feeling something. Their emotions were starting to knock on the thinking part of their mind, going, knock, knock, knock. There's something not right here. There's something not right. Something's not right. And that was all Yeshua wanted to do. That's all they could handle at that point. That's all man could handle at that point in the condition and the state of time that they were in. That's all they could handle. There's enough information to evoke their emotions to send them away feeling something. Feeling that there's something not right. And then later on, after Yeshua died and rose again, in other words, he stood in our stead as a man and did for us what we could not do. What was it that we could not do? We couldn't perform his commands. Remember Adam and Eve? Eve couldn't even perform one command, neither could Adam. That's one command. So what made their children think that they could perform 10 more? You think the Most High gave them those commands to actually have them do them? No. He was testing them to see if they would remember that their mom and dad couldn't even perform one. How about that? And also, not only that, he was testing them to see if they would remember that they were brought out of Egypt into the desert through the blood of a lamb. Remember when they were in Egypt? Remember they were brought out under the blood. That blood was representative of the promise of the Messiah that was going to come to save them. And he was going to perform the commands perfectly. Why? Because he was the creator in a man's body. So he performed for us what we couldn't do, so that he could get man back their eternal life. That was the first thing he did. The second thing he did was took our death, our eternal death. So when he died, he went into eternal hell. But hell couldn't hold him. Couldn't hold him. Why? Because he's the Most High in a man's body. He's the Son of the Most High. His name is Yeshua. His name is not Jesus. It's Yeshua. And so he took the keys of death away from Satan, the only thing that he had to hold us in eternity. So he went into fiery hell. Fiery hell couldn't touch him. Fiery hell, the Most High created fiery hell. It can't do nothing to him. He went in there and snatched the keys of death out of Satan's hand. He said, thank you, hand them over. And Satan was like, here. Yeah. So, my point is, that lawyer was sent away with his emotions stirred, thinking, can he be like the Good Samaritan? His emotions are going, something's not right here. I'm feeling something. You know, and it's the same way with all the parables. All the parables revolve around that same point in one form or fashion or another. With a different inversion on it, but it's the same point. The point is, Yeshua is saying, basically he's saying, oh, so you think you can obey the law of Moses and get your eternal life back based on that, huh? Yeah, here's a story for you. To evoke your emotion to prove to you that you can't. And after I die and raise again, and I send the Holy Spirit down, and I teach Apostle Paul some of the truth, you know, to share with you all, you're going to look back at the time where I walked the earth and spoke to all you Israelites. That includes the disciples. The disciples have no idea what's going on either. They're in just as bad as a condition as the Pharisees and the Sadducees. It's just that the Messiah chose them to be, to later on realize the truth and chose them, the 12, to be as a tool to use to teach other men. So, they were just as blind. They had no idea what was going on. Just as pitiful as condition. They thought that they were performing the law of Moses too. Although they did realize that there was supposed to be a Messiah that would come to save him. And they thought for the most part it was him. Yeah, he's the Messiah. He's come to save us. He's the one that's been prophesied about. He's the one that the Most High told Adam and Eve, your seed will crush the head of the serpent, and the serpent will bruise his heel. Right? That was the promise. That was the promise of the seed that was going to come to save them. So they probably thought to themselves, oh yeah, Yeshua, he's the saving seed. He's probably Messiah. They didn't understand what he was talking about. Oh, they were like, oh hey, you come to set up your kingdom, my brother, or my king. Come on, set it up and let's take things back. These darn Romans got us as slaves, man. Let's get things going on, only. Yeshua is basically, just putting up with them, giving them the same message, sending them away with their emotions evoked, thinking, can I do this thing too? There's something not right. But anyway, after Yeshua rose from the dead and retained victory, once he rose, victory was ours. He did for us, right, what Adam failed. control all of this, and so that we could see and have a historical record and account to look back on for all eternity. And we'll see the writing on the walls of heaven, in the new city, the new Jerusalem, the account. But no matter how hard the angels tried, Satan and the fallen angels, no matter how hard Satan tricked men into thinking that they could be like the Most High, they couldn't do it. And that is wisdom. Knowing that is the wisdom that we get. It's not all this knowledge that men have, all the psychology knowledge. They can build all these great technical buildings and this and that. Foolishness before the Lord. Man's wisdom is foolishness. Foolishness. Real wisdom, the wisdom James is talking about. He's not talking about, oh, believe on the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. No. Understand what the Most High was explaining to us. That is what gives us our salvation. Not believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. Bull pucky. Don't believe that. That's the trick of the devil, man. And it's a big, widespread trick, and everybody has fallen for it. Top of everybody. You know how many people there are on this earth that think that that's the way to salvation? The devil is one wise deceiver. Right? He has wisdom. In fact, Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 11 says he's full of wisdom. Why is he full of wisdom? Because he knows exactly what the plan is. He has all the knowledge and the understanding of what's going on. Right? He's wise, all right. But he's fallen. He's corrupt. His wisdom has become corruptible. He's used his wisdom for corruptible purposes. And now he cannot get back into eternal life at all. He is enraged at the Most High because he has not been given a second chance like we have. We are loved way more than he, the angels. The angels have no second chance. We do. And he is enraged at the Most High for not giving him a second chance. And he's enraged at us. Because the Most High created us and loves us more than him. Loves us more than the angels. To give us a second chance. So Satan is enraged at us. Oh yeah. And he has his big lie spread throughout the earth to take most of everybody living on this earth to hell with him. There's going to be a few people that are going to make it into eternal life. Most everybody else is created for destruction. Think about that. Think about Sarah. Remember Abraham and Sarah? Remember the scripture says something like this? Many are the children of the desolate woman. Of the desolate woman. Many are the children of the desolate woman. Sarah and Abraham only had one child. One. It's a picture, it's a representation of how many people are actually going to be saved. Not very many. The devil has the whole world tricked. And the thing about it is, all those people that have been tricked were created by the Most High to be tricked. Although they were given the choice to choose, the Most High created them, knowing full well that they would not choose. And in fact, he created them to not choose in the first place, even though they had programmed them already that way. And the reason he did it is so that they would be an example. So that those of us who made it into eternity can look at them and say, oh, look what happened to the ones that tried to be like the Most High. And we'll be constantly reminded that He is the Most High. And those that tried it, the Most High punished. They're just vessels of destruction for historical example for those of us that are going to be in eternal life, be on a new earth. This old earth, we're going to live on earth again, still. We're still going to live on the earth. It's going to be a new earth. The scripture says there will be a new earth. And there's no sea. No sea, no oceans. But there will be a river running from the throne of the Most High to water the earth. The river. He's the source of all living water. And there'll be a city, a 1,500 square mile cube city, 1,500 square miles high, 1,500 square miles wide. It's going to be like a cube. That's going to be the city of Earth. It's called the New Jerusalem. It's going to be a city, 1,500 square mile city. Think about that. 1,500 square miles. So how big is 1,500 square miles? That's halfway across the United States. The United States is 3,000 miles from east to west. So the city is going to be half the size of the United States itself. The city of Earth. How about that? Think about that. 1,500 miles high. 1,500 miles wide, and it's going to have pearly gates, gigantic pearly gates, and the gates are going to be remained open, and the foundation of the city is going to be of 12 precious stones laid on top of each other as the foundation. So how about that? A new earth. Brand new earth. And there's going to be animals there. Remember the scripture says what? The lion shall lay down with the lamb.